Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The mayor is not going to be here tonight, so you guys are stuck with me. Does everyone have a chance to look at the minutes from the last meeting?
Yes, sir.
Corrections? Entertained a motion to approve presented? All in favor, raise your right hand. Board of Works are information only. If you have any questions, I'm sure Shaw can answer them.
I'll do my best.
All right. Moving on to old business, do we have an update on 525 Masson?
You skipped one thing, communications.
You want us to set it right now? We need to set the meeting.
Yes.
Okay, sorry.
I would like to.
I was trying to speed things up.
I know.
Go back.
But I want to make sure if you guys want to stick with your normal July, or if you want to do it in June.
I don't have a problem with July.
Okay. Because we could bump it up to June if you chose.
We usually do that second Tuesday in July.
Second Tuesday in July.
And that would be the 11th. So July 11th, 5:00.
Does that work for everybody? If we want to do five, bump it up? Or do, yeah, okay. And dinner is normal?
I'll make that motion.
Got it. Okey dokey, thank you.
Okay, now, 525 Madison Street update. I think the only thing we have there is a demolition contract was executed by the owner. You should have had an email to that effect.
Yes, therefore I believe I forwarded that on.
Okay, update on the yard waste leaf pickup. So we did meet again, we invited Dwayne came. So what we're looking at doing is, after talking to Andy, is removing section 50.50, which is the language talking about the contractors. And then we would set a policy. What we're proposing is we set a policy that the street department will pick up leaves through the month of April. And October 1st or November 30th, the off times will pick up leaves as long as they're bagged. And that's whether they're put there by the homeowner or a contractor within the city limits. The other thing that was brought up about that, an issue, some of the yard bags are being filled with sod and it makes them pretty heavy for the street. So we want to put a 50-pound limit on those bags. That was a suggestion of the committee, we had Dwayne at the meeting. Does anyone have any questions on?
What was the time frame on the, for the?
The month of April, mm-hmm. So in spring cleanup, and
sure.
Then it'd be October 1st, November 30th. So two straight months.
And then with the bagging?
And then if you want leaves removed in between that, you can bag
okay.
them. If
right.
you want the city to pick them up, they need to be bagged just as the grass clippings.
Got it.
Questions? All right. So moving on, golf committee update. Brian, you had, he's got, they met you on the agenda here.
Okay. At one of our previous meetings, I asked a question whether anyone had contacted the school corporation regarding the golf carts, and the answer was no. So I contacted one of the school board members, and he said, well, why don't you come to the meeting? Okay, so I did. All I said was, we're talking about an ordinance. If you have any questions or concerns, any or all of you are welcome to come to the meeting. I don't know if anyone's here or not. okay, yes. But the main issue that they raised was whether the school buses, I guess they on the arm that goes out, they have a camera on them for people who are violating the stop sign, the stop arm. They didn't know if the stop arm would be able to record anybody passing the bus if they had a golf cart. see the vehicle, sure, but I guess now they can see the license plate on a car going past. And so I said, well, they talked about having a sticker on the vehicle somewhere, so if we're going to pass it, that may be something to think about. And if there's someone from the school board here, I don't know if we want to open it up to them or not, but the parent is here.
Do you have something?
I was just gonna see kind of what the state of that conversation was. Is this just something that's being up in the air, or is it something that's probably gonna happen? Do we kind of,
we have an ordinance to read tonight.
Okay.
I'm assuming there will be a vote.
Okay.
Kind of push it off as long as we can.
Yeah, our main thing was just the school bus stop arms, with regards to violations to that, the way that we can track that and ensure that the proper people get warnings and tickets as necessary to hopefully curb that behavior. Is there's a camera on the stop arm that identifies the license plate. That's more of a concern than being able to see the driver because of the difference in camera resolution with regards to the symbolism versus faces. And that information usually gets passed on to authorities. That video is between the school resource officer and the sheriff's department, and that's how the statements get handed out. It's a bit of a concern to us with regards to that because the amount of stop arm violations is still a lot higher than we'd like. So we do have to use those cameras and we do have to see that footage and hand out tickets via the sheriff's department. So that would be something with regards to golf carts that we would be concerned about if they're beholden to all normal traffic laws on the roads, that we would have to have a way to ensure the enforcement of the school bus stop arm laws. That's the only concern that we had talked about at the meeting. I don't speak for the entire board, of course, just here as a member, but that was one of our biggest questions.
I know one thing that was raised last meeting was a question about whether there was concern of students driving those onto school property. Do you know?
I spoke to Jana about that. I got a hold of her last week, and she said they will move on and adapt to whatever the city decides. And they do, I believe they have the authority if they want to ban them on their property, they can do that. Because that becomes a problem. Okay.
I guess the only question I would have is, doesn't the view of the camera go below the license plate anyway? Does it go all the way to the road? And if it does, then you can see
it
what
should.
You need
we
to
just,
see on the golf cart.
We just didn't know what the status was of like what would be required of them to have on the golf cart for identification in that regard. So the camera wouldn't necessarily be the issue so much as what's visible to identify the vehicle.
It don't have to be licensed.
Chief would be able to address that.
I don't think the stickers, the registration stickers I'm thinking of, I don't think you're going to be able to identify registration numbers on that sticker from the bus cameras.
Okay.
I think that'd be difficult to do.
Any other questions?
Right up.
Any other comments? Go ahead and move on. Patience here. She's on the agenda.
She's not here. I will reach back out to her. Some of the day came up, she didn't send me a message that she wouldn't be able to make it. So.
Okay. All right. You're up, Mallory.
I'm up.
You're up.
Your turn. Okay. Well, I am Mallory Hathaway, and my husband and I are opening a business at 602 Main, which was Patience's previous building, I understand. I'm here about a sign variance. I'm a little bit creative. I don't know if you guys know my mom, Jennifer Harris. Jen's Refunk Junk. We like to do things with rusty metal and art. The sign I'm envisioning is 13 long by 3 wide. It will fit greatly right above the windows of the building, and it's made out of welded tools. I'll show you. I passed a picture around. This isn't the final color, but the words Mustard Seed Mercantile would be made out of the historic vintage tools, bolted onto tin, and then onto the building, of course. So that's my idea. Love it or hate it, let me know.
Anyone have any questions? You want me to see the picture passed around?
I'll see it. I brought it in.
Anyone have any objections? Is that the form of the motion?
I'll put that in the form of the motion, then.
Set the variance, all in favor? Alright, easy enough.
Thank you.
Okay, down to ordinances and resolutions, we have the golf cart ordinance. 02-23. We'll entertain a motion for the reading of ordinance 02-23. No motion?
In entirety?
I would think we would do it at some, yeah. This is the first reading, we haven't read it publicly. It's 2 pages long.
Yeah. Move to read by title only.
Okay. Motion?
One second.
Move to second, all in favor for the first reading? Alright, ordinance number 02-2023, an ordinance of the city council. An ordinance of the city council of the city of Rochester, Indiana to establish golf cart use and regulation. Any discussion? Entertain a motion for the second reading?
So moved. Title only.
I'll second.
Moving second, all in favor? Ordinance number 02-2023, an ordinance of the city council of the city of Rochester, Indiana to establish golf cart use and regulation. Okay. Has everyone had a chance to look over the amended ordinance? Any questions?
Issue had been raised about how we would handle babies. Is that, and obviously seating with bucket seats, bench seats, you can accommodate kids, but
I think that's addressed under 7706, letter D. The last sentence says all passengers must be seated at all times. I would assume that would cover that, Andy, is that correct?
So how would we secure like a baby seat if somebody wanted to carry a baby?
Well, there are one of two ways. One is if the chief thinks under the state statute it is unsafe to transport someone under car seat age without a car seat applies to this, I'd have to review that statute to see if that's the case. There are some municipalities who put a blanket age, no one under this age shall be in the car. That was not something that the committee added. We may have discussed it at one point, but I can't honestly recall if that was discussed. But I think that you could probably write someone up for a statutory violation for the unsafe status of that. But I defer to the chief on that. I don't know if anybody's done that.
I don't.
Okay.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Because I don't think we have seatbelts included in anything. I didn't see it.
Seatbelts were not included.
No.
So it would be impossible to secure a car seat or baby seat. So how are we going to handle that? Are we going to put a set age limit and say kids required by law to be in a car seat in a normal vehicle?
Are we allowed to speak at all?
What?
Are we allowed to speak at all?
Oh yeah.
Sure, go ahead.
As a mom of little kids, I would like to be able to drive with my kids without a car seat down the road, going to grandma's house, down to the Elks. We live a quarter of a mile. I would feel very comfortable having my kids sit on my lap right next to me, going 10 miles an hour.
Sitting
next
to
me.
While you're driving. So.
Well, if someone else is driving and I'm holding the baby, so from my point of view, I would like, that would be nice to not have to put a car seat to go right down the road.
It would be convenient, obviously.
pretty slow too.
Yeah, but not everybody's gonna be careful.
A quick search on Google finds that children under the age of 8 must be secured in a car seat or booster seat. Never allow children under the age of 6 to ride in a golf cart. And do not allow people, well, that's drivers. So the most popular search results said no. And in reality, if you get hit by a truck, it doesn't matter what the car seat is in the golf cart. It's just the idea of dropping the baby.
Are parents going to put their children in harm's way like that? I think parents are very protective of their children.
Some.
Yeah, she got a picture from another community that somebody had a child holding a baby in, on a
one picture
road. It's still evidence that people do make bad choices.
I understand that, and again, well, I was alluding to a little bit. At some point, we have to let people make their own decisions for themselves.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
You know, we can't legislate everything. I mean, there's a risk every time I step out of my door. I'm not going to be legislated to stay in my house. Looking from my viewpoint, we looked at this and we've hit it our way. I mean, this is another thing that wasn't specifically addressed, but it is addressed that everyone should be in a seat. If you have an infant that can't sit up in their own seat, well, then that would violate this ordinance because they're not sitting in the seat. I mean, it says in Part D that everyone has to be in the seat. You know, 3 persons on a bench, everyone in the bucket seat. So it kind of addresses it, but it doesn't. And again, you know, are we going to let people make their own decisions for their own? I mean, I would assume people would keep their kids safe. And not always, I understand, but I don't think we can police all of that.
And it is different going down to grandma's house that's three, four houses down compared to, okay, let's head into town. There is a difference. I would hope that the average person today would put their kid in a car seat. I mean, it's totally different. When we were kids, I mean, I yelled at my husband for what in the world did you drive without him in the car seat? And now you wouldn't even think of it, you know, because that was when the law was first passed.
Just because we said it, don't have to have a seatbelt doesn't mean they can't have them.
Right.
Anything else? Any more discussion? We're ready for a third reading. So I'll entertain a motion for a third reading.
So are we gonna just do that, or are we gonna add something related to age?
What would you think would be appropriate?
Well, if it's accurate that it's common to not allow 6 years old and under to be in a golf cart, I don't know if that's.
I'm not sure that's a Google. I just would speak up and say I'm not sure that the quick search on the internet's something that should guide your decision on that.
No.
Because you just heard parents talking, and you know you can't regulate everything. We gotta assume that every parent's gonna take care of their children. We do assume that in our society, right? And can we protect every situation that people make a bad choice? We can't.
Do you want to know where my mind? I have an 8-year-old, 5-year-old, and a 2-year-old grandchild. And honestly, my mind went that my children, because of the 2-year-old, would not get on that golf cart and go any distance at all. Okay? They live in a cul-de-sac, a nice little subdivision, and her mom, my daughter-in-law's mother is always going, oh, I can't believe those kids are riding out on that road on a bike, and I never think twice of it, because people, because of where they're living, people don't drive around that area because there's children all the time walking and dogs and that. And it's very safe for the kids to be out on the bikes. Two different perspectives. I mean, every time I see my daughter-in-law's mom, she's always freaking out. I am not. And I think it's good because then the kids get their freedom. But I know for a fact that my son would never allow them to be on the golf cart because of the little girl's age. The older two, yeah. Because they'll sit. But that little one, they're going to trust her. And they're not going to trust the two older ones to watch her in the back seat. I mean, that's...
But just to give context, because I know what Brian has said is true. I mean, we have to let people make their decisions. But I'm a professional grief counselor, and I work with policemen that have cleaned up messes of kids that have not been taken care of. And it's not pretty. And so that's a very serious concern.
And you'll still have, those police officers will still be dealing with that tragedy, that type of tragedy, henceforth and forevermore,
yep.
Right? Because people don't always make good choices, right?
That's very true. Yeah, that's very true.
All due respect, I have a 19-year-old nephew who just got killed by a drunk driver. You know, he was doing community service. So it's like, you're riding a bike, you're doing picking up trash, like, there's going to be tragedy, you know, always. And we're not negating that fact. But to everyone's point, like, we're parents, so we should be able to have that freedom to say this is appropriate for my child or it's not. But I definitely agree, there's horrible things that happen to kids, and that'd be horrible if that happened to you as a parent.
So sorry.
Can you make changes after the second reading or not?
You could move to amend. And that could be a motion to amend after the second reading.
What would your amendment be?
No, I'm just asking. If we were going to be changing something, we would be able to know the rule, but I'm not advocating pushing it down the road. Right?
If it says they must be seated, and an officer, no matter what, always has the right to stop for unsafe activity, correct? Mm-hmm. I mean, no matter what, if you see something you think is unsafe, Chief, doesn't that give you the right to stop them? And that's just like driving down the road. If I'm driving faster than you think I should in the weather conditions, that gives you the right to pull me over and say I'm driving unsafe.
That's a specific ordinance or a statute that you're talking about, yeah.
So wouldn't that be the same type of thing that if any time someone was observed doing something that was deemed to be unsafe by an officer?
Well, as I read that, if someone's witnessed with a child on their lap, that would be an ordinance violation as it's
right.
written right
mm-hmm.
now.
Right.
So, I think.
That's how I would interpret it.
I mean, it seems like if they have to be seated and you are limiting the number of people that can be on a seat. If you have a bench, you know, typically if you're an adult driving, which that's already determined, and you have someone younger with you, they're probably not going to be on the far side. They're going to be beside granddad, I promise you. And if there's three on that seat, there's another adult on the other side. Back to Brian's point, I think the fact that the person has to be seen, I think you're addressing your issue better than what I think. I think there's an overthinking of the process going on, is my opinion.
And I agree with you, Dave, and there was a group that we went that we put this together. I thought that we did it. And when we came up with it, it was, you know, like three on a bench. If there's two buckets in the front, one of the buckets. And we came up with that, and it was just the most logical way to get around everything and to try to make everybody happy with it. And we came to that as a group, and I think, and I understand your feelings for the baby, Todd. We did not address that point, but I still think that there's the seat ruling, I think is more than, is adequate. I think it's more than adequate. And everyone that was in our group felt that that was adequate.
It also looks like between different counties and the state, looking at a bunch of different sources, that generally there's an occupancy rule. If you had more so than the installed seating would allow your breaking ordinances all over the place. So I don't see why the seating rule would necessarily be an issue here, because if someone had someone on their lap and the cart was full, otherwise technically they'd exceed the occupancy. So in most places that's considered unsafe and they can be stopped.
Yep.
So I think that's kind of built in most places that they have golf cart ordinances by the looks of things. That as long as you're not exceeding the factory installed seating occupancy. Looks like that's the best one around here.
I would say move on to the third reading.
You wanna, should we do entirety or you wanna do title only again?
I think you should do the entirety.
Probably the entirety on the third reading, I mean, since we have not done it as of yet. For public.
Fortunately, I would agree at this point.
Good man.
Entertain a motion.
I'm gonna read it all.
Yeah.
Good man.
Entertain a motion for the third reading of ordinance 2-2023 in entirety.
So move. Second.
All those in favor? Yeah. All right. Ordinance number 2-2023. An ordinance of the City Council of the City of Rochester, Indiana to establish golf cart use and regulation. Whereas the Common Council of the City of Rochester, Indiana pursuant to Indiana Code 9-21 finds that the operation of motorized carts, commonly referred to as golf carts, on private roads, highways, and other public rights of way should be regulated. Whereas Indiana Code 9-21-8-57 provides a golf cart may not be operated on a highway except in accordance with an ordinance adopted under Indiana Code 9-21-1-3A, subsection 14, the Indiana Code 9-21-1-3.3A. Whereas Indiana Code 9-21-1-3A14 provides that the city may regulate or prohibit the operation of golf carts on highways in accordance with Indiana Code 9-21-1-3.3A. Whereas the city desires to accommodate its residents' desire for alternative modes of local transportation while balancing public safety concerns regarding the use of golf carts on Rochester's public street system. Therefore, be it ordained that a new chapter to the Rochester City Code, be known as Chapter 77, is hereby created as follows. 77.01, Section 1, Definitions. For the purpose of this chapter, the following definitions shall apply unless the context clearly indicates or requires a different meaning. Golf court shall have the definition provided by Indiana Code 9-13-2-69.7. As it now exists, the term means a four-wheeled motor vehicle originally and specifically designed and intended to transport one or more individuals and golf clubs for the purpose of playing the game of golf on a golf course. B, operator, shall mean a person holding a valid driver's license issued by the state of Indiana or another state. C, driver's license, shall mean a valid current license to operate a motor vehicle issued by the state of Indiana or any other state. D, financial responsibility, shall mean liability coverage applicable to the golf cart and compliant with all Indiana laws applicable to a motor vehicle operated on the public highway of the state of Indiana. 77.02, Section 2, Intent. It is the intent of this ordinance to allow for the use of golf carts on the local streets within the city. To ensure public safety and welfare, the operation of golf carts must comply with certain vehicle regulations. The operation of a golf cart on city streets is strictly prohibited unless the golf cart is operated and equipped in full compliance with this ordinance. 77.03, Section 3, Minimum Safety Equipment. A, all golf carts operated on city streets shall have the following minimum safety equipment. 1, a rear view and side view mirrors. 2, a bright orange flag affixed to the rear of the golf cart that is a minimum of 6 feet in height from the roadway. 3, a slow-moving vehicle sign that conforms to the provisions of Indiana Code 9-21-9-2 affixed to the rear of the golf cart. 4, brake lights and turn signals. And 5, if operated after dark or before dawn, headlights and taillights. B, all of the minimum safety equipment described above shall be functional and in use at all times while the golf cart is in operation on city streets. 77.04, section 4, registration and inspection. A, no golf cart shall be operated on any city street unless it is registered. B, owners of a golf cart that wish to operate it on city streets must register the golf cart with the Rochester Police Department. The golf cart shall undergo an initial inspection with the Rochester Police Department to determine compliance with the city ordinance and proof of financial responsibility prior to registration. Once the golf cart passes inspection, it may be registered. C, the annual registration fee for golf carts shall be $100. The registration upon issuance shall be valid for the calendar year with each registration issued expiring December 31st of each year. D, the Rochester Police Department is directed to develop and utilize a registration form. Such form shall contain a certification that the operator will observe all traffic laws applicable to the operation of a motor vehicle. The Rochester Police Department shall handle the ordering of all permit stickers and collection of all registration fees. Registration fees shall be placed in the city ordinance fund, and the Rochester Police Department shall receive all funds derived from the registration of golf carts. E, the City of Rochester Board of Public Works and Safety may provide an exception to the registration requirements of this ordinance for good cause. 77.05, section 5, financial responsibility. All golf carts to be operated and used on city streets shall be insured. Proof of financial responsibility shall be in accordance with Indiana Code 9-25-4-4. A person who operates a golf cart on the city street shall at all times maintain the state required minimum amount of financial responsibility for the operation of said golf cart. Proof of financial responsibility shall be carried on the golf cart or operator at all times. 77.06, section 6, general regulations. A, golf carts are prohibited from operating on any part of Main Street or any state road or highway with the exception of crossing the roadway at a perpendicular angle. This prohibition includes all of Main Street, 9th Street east of Main Street, 18th Street west of Main Street, and any part of State Road 25 and State Road 14. B, golf carts shall not be operated on any sidewalk, pedestrian walkway, multi-use path, jogging path, greenway, or trail, except to cross at intersections in a path perpendicular to the path or walkway. C, only persons holding a valid driver's license may operate a golf cart on city streets. The operator must possess a valid driver's license on their person at all times operating the golf cart. D, the maximum occupancy of a golf cart traveling on city streets shall be 1 person per bucket seat and 3 persons per bench seat. All persons riding the golf cart must be seated in one of the manufacturer designed seats and may not be standing or riding on the back or in any place designed for cargo or sporting equipment. All passengers must be seated at all times. E, golf carts must be operated in compliance with all applicable local and state traffic laws, and the operator may be ticketed in the same manner as motor vehicle operators. F, golf carts may park in any public vehicle parking space in adherence with all rules and regulations relating to the parking of vehicles. Golf carts may be parked in private driveways and private areas designated for vehicle parking with the permission of the property owner. G, golf carts may not be parked or stored on a road, street, alley, or thoroughfare overnight. H, golf carts shall not be operated on city streets during inclement weather or when visibility is impaired by weather, smoke, fog, or other conditions. 77.07, section 7, penalty. A, any violation of the provisions of this ordinance or failure to comply with any of its requirements shall subject the offender to a penalty as follows. 1, first offense, $100. 2, second offense, $250. 3, third offense, $500, and revocation of registration. Registration revocation will be in effect for a minimum of 1 year. B, in addition to fees, if public safety requires, a golf cart may be towed at the owner's expense. C, each day of violating this ordinance shall be construed as a separate violation. D, all fines collected pursuant to section 7 shall be deposited in the general fund of the City of Rochester. Right. Any questions?
Comment?
If we did want to take
supplemental reading with the amended amount. You wouldn't have to read the whole thing. You'd have to make sure the free reading was done with the amendment attached. I think that the cleaner way for an ordinance is probably to, prior to the vote, announce the amendment you contemplate, and if the if we proceed to third reading on this and it's unsuccessful, then you bring a motion for an amended.
Okay.
As rather than to amend it, you kind of start the three readings anew with the amendment, your proposed amendment intact. It's probably a cleaner way to do it.
Okay. So vote first, see if it passes.
One thing I would mention as well, if not knowing where the vote lands, if we do pass this tonight, I think it needs to go in effect. We have to give at least a month timeframe to get the necessary registration stickers and get in the police department, get their procedure in place.
I have no idea how long it will take to get registration decals made. I would suspect a couple of weeks at least. So I would need some time. And I'll get that done as quickly as I can. If it were to pass, it couldn't happen tomorrow.
Would the concerns about visible vehicle identification be something to worry about in your regard to registration decals, or would that be something that needs to be put in further?
That would be up to the, I think that would be up to the council, probably
part of the ordinance.
I obviously was just thinking of a decal to put on the fender.
That's kind of what we thought was probably going to be the main thing.
May I ask a question on that? Is it said, if you're concerned about that, if you're taking photos of that and there's video of the people are very visible in a golf cart.
That doesn't mean you know who they are.
Oh.
Yeah, so we don't have like a basis.
It's not like you're trying to look for right? I mean, so what you're saying is the video takes the picture of the license plate on the back of a vehicle?
So the camera on the stop arm is not the best resolution in the world, because that would be expensive to store on the video. And so what happens is that it gets peeled through in the event of a violation, and you can tell because they clearly drive past the stop arm. And that usually goes then through the sheriff's department via our school resource officers.
Okay.
And they peel through and see where they can catch the license plates at. So I don't know all the details of how they see it, but that's what they look for.
Could you put a sticker the size of the letter on a license plate as part of your sticker? Like a R1?
Yeah, like a boat sticker or something?
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Something that's big enough to...
Where's the camera?
R1 is registered.
I think we're just in the
we're talking about stuff and we don't know what's going to happen.
So I have a question. How big a problem have you had with that in the county? Because these have been legal in the county for quite some time.
I'm gonna call for the vote. We're not in a public hearing here. We're gonna entertain a motion for adoption of ordinance 2-2023.
I move to approve ordinance number 2-2023 as presented.
Okay, moved and seconded. Okay. All those in favor of adopting ordinance 2-2023, please signify by raising your right hand. Those opposed?
Okay. I would like to propose an amendment in the 77.03 section 3 minimum of safety equipment as a sixth item that we would add a flashing light to be installed on a high point of the vehicle to ensure better visibility. Flashing light installed on a high point of the vehicle.
At all times, day or night, or just
at all times?
So we have an amendment, so now
his is a motion to introduce a new version of the ordinance with that additional language. So he'd be moving for the first reading.
By title only. So you made a motion to add that amendment. Do I have a second? Second. All right, all those in favor, please signify by raising your right hand. Okay. Anything else, or are we just, any other amendments? We just move forward with the light. So we have another reading.
You move on to second reading.
Or do we have a second reading by title?
All those in favor? Ordinance number 2-2023, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Rochester, Indiana, to establish golf cart use and regulation. Okay, so it's the second reading. We can do it.
Second reading. There's no discussion. And unless you want to do that.
It's gone on long enough. I'll entertain a motion for the third reading of ordinance 2-2023 as amended.
Just read the amendment.
Sure. Ordinance number 2-2023, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Rochester, Indiana, to establish golf cart use and regulation, amended to add in section 77.03, section 3, minimum safety equipment, item 6, add a flashing light to the top of the golf cart. Okay, now I'll entertain a motion for the adoption of ordinance number 2-2023 as amended.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor, please signify by raising your right hand. Okay. All right, we have another ordinance on the docket tonight. Ordinance 3-2023, amending the 2023 salary ordinance for assistant pool director.
Yes, the court order is going to be leading to the next meeting. A modification to their salary for the pool director, the assistant pool director.
That's a wrap.
Now we're going to sing Sneak Home on the Gold Card.
Ordinance number 3-2023, an ordinance amending the salary for the Parks Department. Is there a motion for the second reading of ordinance number 3-2023?
Second.
Right, all those in favor? An ordinance amending the salary for the Parks Department. Ordinance number 3-2023. Sorry. Any discussion, questions?
Move to approve.
We need a third reading.
And since you did it so fast, I missed. I'm just going to say it's the Todd and Brian show again. Okay. Anybody else make a motion?
No, John actually made a motion.
John made a motion.
Sorry, second. So I'm entertaining a motion for the third and final reading of ordinance number 3-2023 by title only.
So moved.
So moved.
All's in favor? Any discussion, questions? Entertain a motion, or entertain adoption of ordinance number 3-2023. Motion to adopt.
So moved.
Second.
All's in favor? And now we have a resolution. Resolution 3-2023, amending our ARP plan. Everybody have a chance to look over it? We have any questions? Looks like maybe we just,
I'm sorry.
Looks like to me we just moved it over to the Apache Drive.
Yeah, I just needed to actually give a resolution amendment.
So it's a resolution. I entertain a motion for the first reading resolution 3-2023. Resolution 3-2023, a resolution adding an addendum to ordinance 7-2021 and resolution 7-2022, our fiscal recovery fund uses plan. Entertain a motion for the adoption of resolution 3-2023.
So moved.
Second.
It's moved and seconded. Sorry. All in favor?
All right. Mr. President, before you move on, past ordinances and resolution. Your vote on the golf cart ordinance. Your ordinance says to be considered the same day it is introduced. Passage of an ordinance has to be by 2/3.
Okay.
When the amended ordinance was suggested, it was introduced for the first time today, and it passed by less than 2/3.
Okay.
So I think that vote did not achieve passage. You have read it twice. You can
to move it to the next meeting.
You can move it to the next meeting and bring a new third reading. And if the vote is the same, it passes. But you cannot pass it tonight because
okay.
You did not pass it by 2/3.
Okay.
Don't tell everybody in the parking lot. Please
don't.
They already went for pizza.
Okay. All right. Down to department reports. You all received Chief Butler's.
Good evening. For the month of March, auto fire alarms, 4 in the city, 1 in Rochester Township. Rush grass fires, 2 in Rochester Township. Mutual aid fires, 3 in Henry Township, 1 in Argus. Accidents, 1 in the city, 4 in Rochester Township, 1 in Richland Township. Medical assist, 18 in the city, 11 in Rochester Township, 2 in Richland Township, 3 in Newcastle Township. Lift assist, 1 in the city, 1 in Richland Township. Gas leaks, 1 in the city. Service calls, 1 in the city, 2 in Newcastle Township. Canceled calls, 3 in the city, 1 in Union Township. Should total 61 calls, and we conducted one night of training. Depending on your questions, that concludes my report.
Questions for Chief? Thank you. Chief Schatz?
For the month of March, we had 14 accidents. One of those were a personal injury accident. We issued 121 warnings, 42 offenses, 34 case reports, 504 calls for service, 22 lockouts, 6 towed vehicles, and 11 people incarcerated. And then you have the list of crimes that those people are lodged for. Other than that, Catherine Dively passed her physical assessment at the academy this past Monday, so she starts her 16-week academy process this coming Monday. And then the Board of Works granted me permission to purchase a Dodge Durango to replace a 2015 Tahoe that has some major mechanical issues. So other than that, that's all I have, unless you have any questions.
Any questions?
Thank you. Right.
Brian, if Heather's here, I don't know if she heads up there or not.
Would you like to speak, Heather?
Okay.
Great.
No, I was just For the street department, really don't have a lot to report other than our normal daily operations. Bulk leaf pickup this year will end on the 15th of May, and a notice went out in the water bill for this coming month. So that will end on the 15th of May, and of course, depending on how the other ordinance goes, and then we'll just be focusing on the month of April next year. For the park department, pool upgrade in the mechanical room is almost finished. They'll be done this week sometime. Spear's done a great job with that, and I think also the park board's next meeting is going to be at the pool. So that's all I have to report, unless you have any questions.
Any questions? Thank you. And thanks again for joining us for the meeting.
Yep.
Partnership, Manitow Association. Ruth, do you have anything for area plan?
I didn't go, sorry, because I had a brand new employee in the kitchen. No one else knew how to cook but me. So. It's a problem.
And Petro did meet. I don't have a report again. It's the same projects are going on. You know, we're dealing with funding as well. So
how's the housing going?
The study. It's underway. I think it'll be good when we kind of get the data and have a direction and we're all pulling together. Right? Mm-hmm. All right. Redevelopment Commission. Park Board.
They met April 10th. Dwayne hit a lot of the highlights there already. But there are a lot of activities going on. Gave a lot of permission to different groups to use the park. Sounds like they're selling golf clubs at the, about sold all their clubs there at the clubhouse. They got a new program called Adopt a Green, which seems to be trying to get some ownership and taking care of the greens with the patrons, which sound like a great idea. The nets are up at the pickleball courts. And that's kind of a quick summation there.
Any questions? Thank you. Mark? BZA and Council on Aging?
Yep, BZA meets tomorrow night with two things on the agenda, both of them fairly usual and small: garage addition and a privacy fence issue. Council on Aging met yesterday, and Transpo is compiling the data. They just had handed out a survey from their writers and any other interested people. I don't know if you saw it or not, but those are in. They're compiling data. They're looking at maybe extending hours if those surveys come back with that. They are looking for a driver. RSVP has had a successful first quarter. They prepared over 70 tax returns for people, free of charge. And they have a trip with 35 people leaving, I think it leaves tomorrow. And rides were just level flat with last year, but for sure gonna see a big increase in rides in April, because it's way up right now. We are looking for another board member, and per our charter, we have half of our members are over 55 and half are younger. We're looking for one younger at this point. We had a resignation from the board. And then I would like to propose to the council, if I could, we have an estimate of over $10,000 to paint the interior of the building. And certainly, a lot of the building is used by the public, not just the people that are in that, working in that building on a daily basis. And I'm wondering if the city would pitch in about $4,000, if we could, to help cover the cost of that, of the paint. The Council on Aging would pick up and do a fundraising for the balance of the money. But $4,000 isn't going to cover half of it, but you know, the building's been used for COVID testing. It's been used for voting. We have that room that is used by the public, a conference room back there for meetings, food pantries there. So there's a lot of people in and out of that building, a lot of the public that we serve. We do own the building. So I'll go ahead and make a motion, if I may, that we provide $4,000, assuming we can get
the money. That's what I was going first for.
Yeah, do we have $4,000?
I was gonna say, actually, because we do own the building, the Board of Public Works budgets maintenance for that building, along with maintenance and some of our other buildings, so.
So you suggest that we kick the can over to them?
Well, I was just gonna say, it's actually, we would be able to cover the whole cost. And since we own the building, because we do have maintenance budgeted for that building in excess of what we, our contribution that we put towards Council on Aging, I would recommend that we take care of the whole $10,000 bill. But we will require two additional estimates, because you'll need three estimates on the cost. So I don't know if Doug put that together or get the quote?
Well, it's awfully nice of you to offer the total.
I mean, if they want to do a fundraiser, they're more than welcome to.
Well, they applied for a grant, which they 90, you know how that goes. Mm-hmm. They're 99% sure that's going to come. I think 4,000 would really
cover part
cover.
Of it. Then what I would recommend is because it is actually out of the Board of Works budget, I mean, you're welcome to take a vote and approve that, but it's already budgeted, it's already there. There doesn't really need to be an additional step of approval. Correct. Other than the Board of Works being documented in the Board of Works minutes, that there will be an expense coming out for that amount. So I can take it to the Board of Works that the council recommends 4,000 because they're obtaining a grant and some other things, so they won't need the full 10,000 from us. And I'm sure that won't be an issue with them, but we have it allocated already.
So it'd be appropriate to move for a $4,000 contribution.
If you feel that's comfortable.
To the painting renovation of the city building.
Okay, so we move to recommend.
I'll second that one.
And Shadi, you'll pass that on.
I will, yes, they meet next week.
You need a vote on that?
I mean, you go ahead and finish your vote if you like, but.
Sure.
All in favor. It'll look better.
Thank you, everybody.
I got a motion in a second. Might as well finish it.
And you want to have a treat, come and watch the seniors play chair volleyball. It is a very spirited activity and a nice workout for them. So there's a lot of fun going on there.
All right.
Thank you. That concludes my report.
Any questions for Marty? Todd, do you have anything on solid waste and animal adoption?
We do not. They only meet every other month, and this was the off month.
Okay. Any questions for Todd? All right. Marty and Ness, Brian.
I was not able to go to the last tree board meeting, but I do know that they are working on finishing up any projects, but any removals or anything that happened last year that wasn't able to get done because of the weather, that we're gonna be getting those done, and the next round is getting ready to go out. So, and I would imagine that with the leaves coming out on the trees, there's gonna be some trimming that's gonna coming up. And we meet again next week, so I should have a good report there.
When's the next tree board meeting?
Wednesday the 3rd.
Yes, Wednesday the 3rd at 9 a.m.
Right early.
And do they meet here?
They do.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing to add.
Any questions for Brian? Thank you. All right, water board, John?
As we can say, the water board, everything is running smooth at the plant. The only business that we really had was that they're going to get a new truck. The one they have is an older Dodge, and I think it might be here 15 in age by a couple of years, but it is in dire repair. And so Marvin put them on the lookout for another 1500 size truck. And everything else is going good, and it was a short meeting.
I do. In looking at the ordinance I mentioned, I don't think you can view your vote as a nullity because 2/3 of you didn't vote. It was vote. The ordinance doesn't say you can't take the vote. What it essentially says is because you introduced it at this meeting, you needed 5, not 4. So I think the record on that is closed. If you want to make the record clean and have that third vote, Councilman Wilson can make the exact same motion he made a moment ago. You have a new first, new second reading on the amended version, and then save the third. I don't think we can just have the third one next time because you had a third reading and you had a vote.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that having looked at this while you were talking, I think that the way it's phrased is not that you can't have that third reading and vote. It's that you had it, and as strange as it sounds, it failed because it only got 4 votes. Okay. So my suggestion is if you want to go back to as if you preserved that, then essentially repeat the process from that caused the amendment and the first and second reading, if that's how you want to proceed. You follow me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So
just Councilman Wilson could repeat his motion for first reading of the amended version, and you could do that by title only, first and second reading.
I thought we did first and second readings with the amendment.
You did.
Okay.
But then you had a third one and you voted and it failed.
Because it was 4-3.
Because it was only 4.
Okay.
And so my statement is the reason to repeat it is so that the record would show you definitely had first and second reading on a new motion in April, and then at your next meeting would be your third reading, if that makes sense. Or you could do nothing. But I think as it stands, you voted on that and failed.
Or we could do all the readings next meeting.
But if you do all the yes, you could do all the readings next meeting, and if you vote on it after third reading, you will need 5 next month. Because you'll need to get 2/3 people voting in favor.
Is that because they're suspending the rules and moves the third reading? Is that why?
Yes, it doesn't. Our ordinance doesn't use the phrase suspend rules. It allows for the third reading if there's no objection proceeding to the third reading. But once you do that in one meeting, the same meeting you introduced it, you need 2/3, not a simple majority.
So we would have to have first and second reading this month.
Correct.
And postpone.
And that is more common. We pass a lot of things in the same meeting that we raise them because it's expedient to do so. But
they're usually unanimous.
But they're usually unanimous. The rules are set up in that. They're set up kind of to discourage that, number one, And then you really, you can only proceed to third reading if there's no objection to having the third reading as the same as the first, same night as the first. And this rule about having two thirds kind of is meant to
slow things down.
Discourage rushing things through that are of import.
I make a motion that we have the first reading with the amended version.
A motion on the floor.
Second.
Moved and seconded.
By title only.
All those in favor?
So the motion is what?
To read first reading by title only.
Tonight.
All those in favor? Ordinance number 2-2023, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Rochester, Indiana, to establish golf cart use and regulation. Entertain a motion for a second reading.
So moved. By title only.
I'll second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor for the second reading? Ordinance number 2-2023, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Rochester, Indiana, to establish golf cart use and regulation. Okay. Any ADA concerns?
No. I apologize. I was writing.
Go on,
Todd.
Entertain
a
motion.
It was it, right? I just slowed it up.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.